Welcome to the Northampton City Council meeting of April 6, 2017. I'm City Council President Bill Dwight, and I'll be presiding. Before we convene and take the roll, determine whether we have a quorum, and it's looking pretty good. We'll open the floor up to public comment, and this is an opportunity for the public to speak on any issue. You're not constrained by our agenda. You are constrained, however, by time. You're allowed 3 minutes to speak. After you identify yourself and you step up to the podium, say your name and your address, and then if you speak, and you know, I often say preserving the decorum of the chamber. I realize that's kind of an ambiguous statement as to, you know, what the standards are, but we ask you not to defame other people. You can defame your elected representatives. That's what we signed up for. And but if you have a problem with your neighbor shall remain nameless, please. Also, let's see. I think that's it. I think that's pretty much it. So if you, when you'll see this clock above me, the once you state your name and address, then Pam starts the clock, and please keep your comments within that 3 minutes. First up, David Arbeiten, please.
Good evening. David R. Beitman, D-A-V-I-D-A-R-B-E-I-T-M-A-N. I live at 357 North Farms Road in Florence, Mass. And what I'm bringing to the council is an idea that I have, which is really spurred by what I feel is an attack on the Bill of Rights at the highest levels of government, beginning with the presidency. And my proposal is quite simple. I believe that in order for our democracy to survive and thrive, that one needs an informed citizenry, and that I would propose that we post the Bill of Rights very prominently, perhaps on a 3-foot by 5-foot poster in City Hall, and in our middle schools and in our public schools, so that people who are citizens and students are more informed about what their rights are. Secondly, I'd like to propose some kind of city-wide celebration and informational event, possibly on the anniversary of the approval of the Bill of Rights. There are two dates in terms of when it was approved and when it was ratified. And third, to see if we could better get civics back into our schools so people and our students understand what the foundations of democracy are. I feel that with the current administration that the First Amendment is under attack in terms of freedom of speech, freedom of the press. Establishment of religion is under attack in terms of using school vouchers for religious schools used by, paid by taxpayers, as well as other things that a law and order candidate would probably support, such as tracking devices on our vehicles, which represent unreasonable search and seizure. I also think that the whole prison issue is critical, and that prisons today, with being overcrowded and violent, are cruel and unusual punishment. So I think that we can do something on a very local level, and I would like to see if there is some way of Northampton perhaps leading the way in Massachusetts, where other cities within our state might follow and other states might follow our lead. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Sharon Moulton, please.
I'm Sharon Moulton, and I live at 48 Evergreen Road, Unit 313 in Leeds. And I am extremely happy with my elected officials in this room, and am very happy with the things that you've been considering that I've been here listening to. And I saw on the agenda that you're going to discuss a resolution in support of the Safe Communities Act. And so I'm saying, I'm going to cry. I'm saying thank you very much for doing that and for putting Northampton on a list of communities and putting pressure on the legislature to act. I want to say that I was attending the Northampton cluster of the Interfaith Sanctuary and Solidarity Network that's come out of the Pioneer Valley Workers Center movement. And there were about 20 of us last night from about 10 local gatherings. And one of the things on the list of how to provide sanctuary and solidarity is helping in any way we can to have the Safe Communities Act passed. And I brought up, hey, it's on the agenda in Northampton tomorrow. And someone said, Sharon, could you represent us? So I'm representing the group that I was with last night that represents a lot of the interfaith community that is very happy that you're doing this and hopes that it's a unanimous vote. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Wayne Tebow, please.
Wayne Tebow, 830 Chesterfield Road, Florence. I've owned a large tract of land that's affected by the rural incentive, or the overlay, that's supposedly going to be removed. And I've probably owned it for approximately 25 years. And right now, it's kind of landlocked, but not to say in the future if I purchase some frontage, it could be developed one way or the other. But I just found out from the meeting in March that it was already removed, the rural incentive, 2 years ago. And now they're looking for, they have a public hearing to remove the overlay from the map after it's already been removed, which to me makes no sense because it's been already removed. And I just thought that I was looking at the minutes of the city council meeting and the public hearing that was held, and it's very confusing. I even think for some of the members of this rural incentive, how it works and so forth. And being that I owned it so long, the property so long, and find out 2 years later that it was removed, I thought that, or I believe that there should be a public notification before this is done, like a lot of other issues we do in zoning in this city and so forth, and not after the fact. And the rural incentive, one of the reasons they talked about is that it's more traffic. Well, traffic's increased everywhere in the city, and the utilities and so forth, but that water usage and the sewer, but that wasn't an increase because of the rural incentive. That was an increase of zoning changes for like River Valley going to business, and but nothing basically that I could see for affordable housing. And really, if the city cares a lot about affordable housing, why, if it's on the books there still, that incentive, how does it really affect the future, except the opportunity may come that affordable housing could be added in that area? And what I've noticed over the years, that most of that property up in that whole area, where my property abuts too, has actually been purchased for open space, not for affordable housing. Thank you.
Thank you. One of the things, I'm sorry, that I didn't mention when I was explaining about the public comment is that the council is constrained from speaking, so there can't be an exchange of, but I would say that there's an opportunity to follow up and discuss that with the councilors and or also the planning officials, so that we can get a little clearer as to at least a better understanding of the process. And that's all we have signed up. Is there anyone else interested who would like to speak at this time? Okay. I'm going to ask the administrative assistant to please call the roll.
Counselor Bidwell.
Here.
Counselor Dwight.
Here.
Counselor Klein.
Here.
Counselor LaBarge.
Yes.
Counselor Murphy.
Here.
Counselor Nash.
Here.
Counselor O'Donnell.
Here.
Counselor Shara.
Here.
Okay, we have a quorum. Counselor Carney is absent with excuse. So we'll start with 1 minute announcements. Counselors, anyone have a 1 minute announcement?
Don't have to.
Oh, okay. Go for it.
I just want to, and I think everybody has read in the paper, excuse me, that our city clerk is retiring at the end of June. And I want to thank Wendy and all her staff for working tirelessly, and that it is going to be very difficult to try to fill her shoes, but hopefully we'll find somebody. But I want to thank them all for how they worked tirelessly in the elections that we had during the summer. A lot of vacations had to be held back, and there's a lot of work in that office, and I really feel that people really don't realize what's involved in there. So I want to thank Wendy Mosna and her staff.
Thank you for doing that. I agree. I don't think you'll find a note of dissent here on the council, but thank you for taking the time and mentioning that. 1 minute announcements? I have some. I have one. This is a letter. This dear Northampton parents/guardians, if you have a student in grade 6 through 12, we need to hear from you. Your input is essential in helping Northampton Prevention Coalition to plan our substance abuse of prevention and education programs. Now, prevention is worth a pound of cure, so give us 5 minutes and we'll give you a chance to win your choice of $100 Visa gift card or $100 Hampshire YMCA gift card. And the survey is online, can be found at the following link. Now, I'm going to read you a link, but I suggest you check this online because it's www.surveymonkey.com/r/NPCParents2017. So I don't expect you to memorize that, but there you go. Any other comments? I mean, recognitions? Nothing. All right. So we go to resolutions. We move right to resolutions. Now, this may seem like we're moving fast. We're not. This is going to be a long night. It's just to get everyone heads up. First up is item 17.266. This is a resolution to adopt the FY18 through FY22 capital improvement program. This is the first reading for this.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. And this is a resolution to adopt the CIP for FY2018 to FY22, submitted to the City Council on February 28th, 2017, upon the recommendation of Mayor Narkowitz. And be it resolved that the City Council hereby adopts the capital improvement program for FY2018 to FY2022. And this is submitted by the Mayor on February 28th, 2017, in accordance with the Charter of Northampton, Massachusetts, Article 7, Finance and Fiscal Procedures, Section 7.5, Capital Improvement Program. Any discussion on this item? Councilor Klein.
Well, we did have a hearing on this just a few nights ago, and I brought up some concerns there, but I'd like to bring them up here in the full City Council. One of the concerns I have is about the $250,000 that are earmarked in the capital plan for a design study of the removal of Upper Roberts Meadow Dam. I'm concerned that we're putting more money into a design for something that doesn't need to happen. And I would really encourage the mayor's office to work with the folks who have studied it very in a very in-depth way, that live in the area and have alternate suggestions about how it can be handled, so we're not spending this amount of money on removing something like that. The other piece that I had question about that I brought up at the meeting was some of the expenditures associated with the police department. I really appreciate that Chief Casper wrote a memo. I read it very carefully, and it was very helpful. It helped me to really understand some of the questions I had about some of the tactical training pieces, some of the equipment. I still have some questions about the riot control gear because it seems excessive to me. It seems like things that we have never had to use in Northampton. I can't imagine us, our police force, needing to use plexiglass shields and helmets and things like that for crowd control. And the notes that Chief Casper provided in her letter didn't feel addressed the need for those things sufficiently. I think that those are things that are used really just for riot control, and I can't imagine our police force needing to employ that kind of equipment. So I just wanted to bring up those two questions that I continue to have, concerns that I continue to have, but other than that, I absolutely support the capital plan.
Councilor Murphy.
The upper Roberts Meadow Dam is being removed at the request of the Office of Dam Safety of the Commonwealth because they ordered us to remove it. The decision to remove it was made years ago, and this is probably one of the last financial orders relative to getting it out of there. So it's pretty much a settled issue that it has to go at the request of the Office of Dam Safety. And this is probably the last money we'll spend on completing that project. The capital plan for FY18, which is the one we're pretty much voting on tonight, does not include the police gear. That's in next year's. So I think the only thing the police is asking for this year is money for dog kennel. So the police riot gear actually will come up again next year when it's actually in the 19 budget. So we do have time on that one. We're not essentially approving that tonight.
Councilor Barge.
Right. I'm going to support what Councilor Klein talked about on Roberts Meadows Dam. I have been working with my residents for quite a long time about saving that dam. And I have to disagree with Councilor Murphy because I don't think I've seen him attend any of the meetings there. And that dam is very, very valuable. And I think that there is a way that we could save that dam. I really do. It's like you're looking at a dam that's been there forever, forever, forever. And to go ahead and spend that kind of money, I really feel our mayor also could help save that dam. I just believe in it, and I think that to just say, yeah, we're going to tear it down because they said we have to do this and do that, I disagree with you, Councilor Murphy. It can be saved, and this is a tremendous amount of money.
Anyone else on those issues or other issues relative to the capital improvement program? Councilor Bidwell.
Just two things. One, just a procedural question. I was not at the hearing last week, so I apologize. This recommendation did this come forward with a positive recommendation from finance? It
yes.
Did. Okay. Just want to understand that. On the matter of the Roberts Dam, I do not have a great deal of history with it, and I respect the recommendations that come from the state on a matter like this. As well as our duty to comply. But I have heard several folks whose opinion I respect say that the situation that prevailed at the time of those studies has changed rather dramatically, specifically that the amount of silting that is accumulated now means that the volume of water that's in there, if there were to be a catastrophic failure, would not do anywhere near the damage that was the case at the time of those engineering studies. So I would just like to know that had been taken into account in any decisions to proceed.
Councilor Dunn.
Just to say something, I think everyone knows the capital program is not a budget. It's a five-year plan that the mayor put together, and all the councilors know that. So some of this debate could be saved for when we actually get to the actual financial order, although bringing up concerns, I think, is perfectly fine and healthy. So I note that a vote in support of this program is not necessarily an endorsement of every single last thing. It's more endorsement of the whole process. And so on that note, I would just say in general, I have tremendous faith in this capital program, this five-year program. In general, I think it makes very wise investments in the fundamentals that people care about in our city, like our schools and our roads and public safety. So I'm going to definitely support the capital program, and I think the specifics of any budget, as we know, we won't garner universal agreement or unanimity, but I think we can iron out those details in the future as we get to each one. But definitely support the capital program budget for today.
Discussion or comments on the capital improvement plan program? Okay, hearing none, I'm going to ask the administrative assistant to call the roll on this.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Scherer?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
That passes in first reading. So let's see. Second, gonna get there. Should have been a little more heads up about this.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. You got it? Okay. Thanks. We're by computer here. So the next is item 17.287. This is a resolution to support of the Senate Bill 1305, and that's an act to protect the civil rights and safety of all Massachusetts residents, aka the Safe Communities Act. And this is the first reading of this, now I have to change all my mindset here. So this is upon the recommendation of Councilors Elisa Klein, Councilor Maureen Carney, and Councilor Gina Louise Shara. This is in support of Bill S1 1305, an act to protect. Well, I just said that. Whereas Northampton Mayor David J. Narcotz issued the city's executive order on August 28, 2014, directing the Northampton Police Department to, quote, not honor or enforce any detainer request from the U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement. And despite threats from the current U.S. presidential administration that the federal grant funds to, quote, sanctuary cities, close quote, will be withdrawn, has pledged his continued commitment to ensuring the order be enforced. And whereas the Northampton City Council, in its November 20th, 2014 resolution supporting the mayor's executive order, committed to ensuring that the protections enforced in the order are applied consistently and fairly. And whereas, in addition to Northampton, cities in Massachusetts, including Amherst, which is a town, Somerville, Cambridge, Boston, Holyoke, Lawrence, Chelsea, Orleans, and Springfield, have all passed trust acts, resolutions, or other policies designed to limit local law enforcement cooperation with Immigration and Customs Enforcement, or also known as ICE, and are referred to as, quote, sanctuary cities, close quote. And whereas legal experts, including the Massachusetts Attorney General Maura Healey, have stated that the proposal made by President Trump to strip sanctuary cities and states and cities of federal grant money is an unconstitutional attempt to coerce local policy by manipulating federal funds. And whereas immigration enforcement in the United States was explicitly established as the responsibility of the federal government in Fong Yu Ting versus U.S. in 1893, and over the last two decades, local jurisdiction states have been compelled to increase their immigration enforcement role, beginning primarily with the 287G provision of the Illegal Immigration Reform and Immigrant Responsibility Act of 1996, and increasing dramatically throughout the 21st century. And whereas the increasing cooperation between local law enforcement agencies and the Department of Homeland Security causes us to have significant constitutional and human rights concerns because of immigration enforcement practices such as racializing policing, lengthy periods of detention, excessive transfer of immigrant detainees, violations of immigrants' rights to due process. And whereas studies have shown that immigrants are less likely to report crimes when state and local law enforcement agencies cooperate with federal immigration enforcement, thus diminishing trust between the communities and law enforcement and putting immigrant victims and potential victims at heightened risk. And whereas the current bill in the 190th General Court of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, again, Senate 1305, an act to protect the civil rights and safety of all Massachusetts residents, also known as the Safe Communities Act, aims to protect all residents of Massachusetts and build trust within communities by limiting cooperation between local law enforcement and agencies and ICE. And whereas the Safe Communities Act will ensure due process rights for people detained for civil immigration violations, prohibit law enforcement from inquiring about a person's immigration status unless required by law, prevent law enforcement agencies from arresting or detaining a person solely based on immigration status, and limit information sharing between state and local law enforcement and DHS. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the City Council of Northampton, Massachusetts, remains committed to ensuring equal, just, and fair treatment of all persons who live in and visit the city, and to maintaining our status as a sanctuary city. And be it further resolved that we support the Massachusetts Safe Communities Act and urge its passage by the Massachusetts Senate and House of Representatives. And we ask that the Governor Charles Baker, who has expressed support for sanctuary cities, to support this statewide bill and to sign it in a timely manner to ensure the protection of all residents of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And be it further resolved that we commend and support State Representative Peter V. Cocott for being one of the petitioners of S-1305. And be it further resolved that the administrative assistant to the City Council shall cause a copy of this resolution to be sent to U.S. Senator Elizabeth Warren, U.S. Senator Ed Markey, Massachusetts Governor Charles Baker, Massachusetts Attorney General Maura Healey, Massachusetts Senate President Stanley Rosenberg, Massachusetts State Representative Peter V. Cocott, the original co-sponsors of the S-1305, as well Massachusetts Senator James B. Eldridge, the Massachusetts Representative Juana Matias, and the co-chairs of Massachusetts Legislature's Joint Committee on Public Safety and Homeland Security, and Massachusetts Senator James E. Timothy, and Massachusetts Representative Harold P. Naughton. So, has this been moved and put on the floor yet? No, I'll accept the motion.
So moved.
Second.
Councilor Klein.
In discussing this with the co-sponsors, we'd like to postpone discussion and vote on this in order to have Councilor Carney here as one of the co-sponsors, and also because we suspect we may have a long discussion on this, and we have a very long meeting with financial orders, so we'd like to table this to our April 20th.
Yeah, our 420 meeting, yes, yeah. Well, we just did. Councilor Klein motion, and then Councilor Scherer seconded.
I didn't hear you.
So. Okay, so then maybe I need to ask about the timeliness of this. This is still in committee, but we don't know where it is in the committee at this point.
They're within the next 2 weeks scheduling a hearing, we're told, but that gives us that 2 weeks until our next meeting, so I think we're okay.
So we may consider this the first reading, but we could do two readings in the next meeting if it needs to be expedited. If the sponsors are okay with that.
Yep.
Okay, so the request by the sponsors is to postpone. So we'll do that. But at least folks know the nature and intent of this resolution and have opportunities to discuss it in public as well, so. We'll actually, now because it's been put on the floor, we'll probably need a motion to postpone it.
To postpone.
Second.
All those in favor of postponement, please say
aye.
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 Okay. Next up, we have the consent agenda. This is to refer to various appointments to the Committee on City Services. On Planning Board, we have Ann Brooks of 20 Bridge Road, Unit 1, Northampton. This is a term starting March 2016, expiring June 2019. This is a reappointment. Mark Sullivan of 83 Maynard Road, Northampton, term to start March 2015 and expire June 2018, also a reappointment. John Lutz of 291 Haydenville Road in Leeds, term starting March 2015, expiring June 2018. Again, another reappointment. Central Business Architecture, Robert Walker, 13 Fort Street, Northampton. The term beginning April 2017, expiring June 2020. This is a reappointment. Ellen Tierney, 30 Francis Street of Northampton. The term starting April 2017, expiring June 2020. Also a reappointment. Council on Aging, John Kaczynski Jr. of 39 Lino Terrace in Florence. The term to start April 2017, expiring June 2020, a reappointment. Trust Fund, Staunton Williams Jr. at 11 Barrett Place in Northampton. The term to start November 2015, expiring June 2018, also a reappointment. The Board of Registrars, Sandra Hallowell is 43 Lady Slipper Lane in Northampton. The term to start April 2017, expiring June 2020, a reappointment. Disability Commission, Ruth McGrath of 52 Longview Drive in Florence, the term starting November 2016, expiring June 2019, also a reappointment. And Conservation Commission, Tim Partial of 76 North Street in Northampton, term to start March 2017 and expiring June 2020, a reappointment. And finally, the Redevelopment Authority, Tara Brewster of 67 Chestnut Street in Florence, the term to start April 2017, expiring June 2018. This is replacing the unexpired term of Royce and Quinn. And then also an approval of the minutes for March 16th, 2017. Is there a motion?
To approve.
Motion's made. Second?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor of the consent agenda, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Okay. Well, now we're into it. Here comes the meat. We're going to go into recess, and then it's opening it as the Finance Committee that is chaired by Council Murphy. So we have a meeting within a meeting, and I now figuratively pass the gavel to Council Murphy to preside.
Thank you. Pam, would you call the roll of Finance, please?
Council Murphy?
Here.
Council
Yes.
Council Nash?
Here.
The first order of business is the approval of minutes from the meeting of March 16th. Do we have a motion?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. On to the financial orders. Upon the recommendation of Mayor David J. Narkowitz, this is R17.226, a resolution to adopt the capital improvements program for FY18-22, submitted to the City Council on February 28th. 2017. Resolved that the City Council hereby adopts the Capital Improvements Program FY 2018-2022 submitted by the Mayor on February 28, 2017 in accordance with the Charter of Northampton, Massachusetts, Article 7, Finance and Fiscal Procedures, Section 5-7, Capital Improvements Program.
We actually just passed that.
And there's an order for it, actually. Further on?
No.
Excellent. We'll consider that one disposed of then.
Seems so.
Thank you.
Yeah.
The charter says by resolution.
Right.
And it says the council shall adopt the CIP by resolution, which you did.
Which we did
already. Which I already did.
Yeah.
And there's no other, the orders are.
So having a recommendation from this committee would be
moot. Would be moot at this point. Excellent. Moving right along then. We disposed of that one quickly, didn't we? Upon the recommendation of the mayor, this is 17.267, in order to authorize the payment of a prior fiscal year bill, order that the council authorizes payment of a prior fiscal year bill from the Veterans Department of $275 to the Durham School Services for transportation of students to the Memorial Day Parade in Florence, May 2016. Do we have a motion?
Make a motion.
Second?
Second.
All right. Any discussion? Mayor, do you want to?
Just
lingering bill from last year.
It was just a case of the bill got mailed to the school department. It should have been mailed to the Veterans Department, and then it got lost in translation. So it eventually found its way to the Veterans Department. Yeah.
Almost a year later. Any more discussion on this one? All in favor of a positive recommendation of Finance?
Aye.
All right. The next one is upon recommendation of the mayor. This is 17.268, in order authorizing the senior services to accept a gift of $5,000 or less. Order that whereas the Northampton Senior Services received numerous gifts of tangible personal property each year, and whereas the Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 44, Section 53A½, provides that acceptance of gifts of tangible personal property require a vote of the City Council and approval of the mayor, whereby many of the gifts received by the Northampton Senior Services are of relatively low market value, and whereas it's in the best interest of the Northampton Senior Services and the city to streamline the process by which gifts of certain value may be accepted and placed into service for the Northampton Senior Services in the community. Now, therefore, it be ordered that the city hereby authorizes the Director of Senior Services to accept gifts of tangible personal property with a fair market value of $5,000 or less from the federal government, a charitable foundation, a private corporation, or similar statutory entity, individual, or from the Commonwealth or any political subdivision thereof. The Director of Senior Services shall use such gifts for the restricted purpose provided by the donor, or if no restriction is attached to the gift, for such other purposes that the director deems advisable. Motion to finance? Second? The mayor has commented on this one.
Just the council may recall that you've adopted similar resolutions for both the police department and the school department. And basically, it's for low dollar gifts because by the letter of the law, we would have to bring any gift to the city council, any gift of real property to the city council to be accepted. So this is an attempt to kind of streamline that process for smaller items, which the senior center frequently brings. So that's why we are doing this.
Mm-hmm. Any counselor?
I have this remarkable deja vu. I thought we already
do
it every year for the senior center, though. Do we have to do it annually?
No, I don't believe so. We did one for the police department, and we did one for the.
Well, I mean, I don't think I see any harm or redundancy, but okay. It struck me that we were talking about this one.
We did it for the revolving.
Right.
Funds,
right. Okay.
But that's a different.
Right. No. Thank you.
Yeah, that's a different story. Yeah, yeah. This is just for general gifts of. I have a chair that I'd like to donate, or right. I have a whatever, and so. By the letter of the law, we would have to bring an order to City Council and getting authorization from the council and the mayor to accept the chair. So that's why we want to do this instead. Similar to the police who receive teddy bears and dog toys and the schools who receive computers and things like that. So it's just, and PTO gifts, it's a way to streamline it. So I don't believe we've done one like this, but.
Councilor Barnes?
Yeah, so Mayor, if anything is below the 5,000, it does not have to come to City Council, correct?
That's correct, yes.
It's the same thing.
So we don't have to do this annually?
No.
Is there any logic to a more expansive order at some point that grants permission not just to specific departments, but to really any department under the jurisdiction of the mayor? So that we don't have to keep doing these?
You certainly could.
Just a thought.
It's something that we've only done for, I think three departments now. We certainly could do something like that, yeah.
We'll spend more time talking about it today than we can say. Thank you.
Well, definitely, I guess I'm trying to think of other departments that get those kinds of gifts, and I think we've sort of covered the bases.
Okay. Thank you.
Councilor Nash?
People throw their shovels at the DPW, but I don't think that's a gift.
They want them back.
Yes.
Why $5,000? I mean, where did that come from? Or
I think, typically we're trying to set a number that's low and that, at least, we've done similar parameters like on the school committee where we've authorized the because the school committee also has to vote to accept gifts, and so we've set a lower number. The idea being that if it was some really expensive item, it may not be something that the city wants to take on the liability for, or something. And so it may just be better to have the council and mayor approving larger type gifts, like here's a nuclear generator for the or something like that. I'm just being facetious, but some large item. a car or something like that, which has inherent liabilities. And so it just feels like that's not something that a department head should be deciding, that it probably should come to the city council and mayor for approval. So that's why we want to pick a lower number.
Yes. So as an example, would it be the, like, the PVTA bus or the van that's coming to the senior center?
Yeah, we already did an order on that.
Right, but it would be something like that, because you're mentioning a
Yes, car exactly. Car. Something larger like that, we would come to the city council. Exactly. Yeah. Yep. Exactly.
Any other questions on this one? Then all in favor of a positive recommendation of finance, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? All right, the next one is, again, upon the recommendation of the mayor, this is 17269, an order to authorize the appropriation of $1,465,692 from free cash for central services, the Office of Planning and Sustainability, the IT Department, Fire Rescue, Schools, and DPW Capital Projects. Order that pursuant to the FY 18 to 22 capital improvements program, the following capital projects be appropriated from the FY 2017 general fund undesignated fund balance. Now, these are things that we are paying cash for, not borrowing. This is cash purchases, okay? From central services, the Florence Fire Station roof replacement for $121,000, the main fire station EMS upgrades for $75,000, replace department vehicles with fuel efficient vehicles for $45,000, and Forbes Library fire alarm and smoke detector system upgrades. Those are from central services. From planning and sustainability, rail trail extension designs for $60,000, tax title for city property purchases $40,000, and the climate adaption plan for $70,000. Information technologies, replacement of equipment for $50,000. Fire rescue, the rescue boat replacement for $35,000. From the Northampton Public Schools, math investigation, textbooks, and software for $125,000. District-wide security camera upgrades for $50,000. Jackson Street School cafeteria HVAC repairs for $40,000. Multi-phase upgrade of building EMS at the high school for $100,000. Replacement of lockers at the JFK Middle School pool for $50,000. Also, Northampton Public Schools, Leeds Elementary School Phase 1 parking lot repaving $85,000. Robert K. Finn Ryan Road School replacement of the gym floor for $75,000. Leeds and Bridge Street Elementary School's early childhood playground equipment $50,000. From the Smith Vocation, for the Smith Vocational Agricultural High School, cafeteria walk-in freezer for $60,000 and an agricultural high school classroom intruder lock for $40,000. From DPW, for traffic calming $25,000, sidewalks for $50,000, bridge road traffic signal replacement for $100,000, wood waste disposal for $10,000, a storage facility for $75,000, and cemetery improvements for $10,000. The total of all these is $1,465,692. Do we have a motion to finance?
Second.
And the mayor's here.
Again,
do you have any questions?
Each one of these projects are ones that are outlined in greater detail in the capital improvement program. So there's a summary for each one of these. And obviously the one thing to note is that these are this particular order is using our free cash. Which we are every year, one of the reasons for, generating free cash is to be able to use it for one-time expenses, and we use it for a good chunk of our capital improvement programs, our capital investments. So this order just focuses on using free cash.
Mm-hmm. Questions on any of these?
No, I think, Councilor, maybe you could explain. This was brought up at the hearing.
Oh, yeah, these are all of the things we're talking about tonight were at our Monday public hearing. This is just the orders for them in council. Councilor.
I just want to comment that it's sad and a sign of the times that we're spending $40,000 on locks to keep threats out of classrooms, and that we're also spending $50,000 on security cameras, again, at schools. I know it's necessary, but it's a
it's a pretty terrible expense. Anyway.
Any other questions on finance? Hearing none, all in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Great. All right, the next one is again upon the recommendation of the mayor. This is 17.270, in order to appropriate $770,000 from the capital stabilization for schools and public safety projects, order that pursuant to the FY18-22 capital program, the following capital projects be appropriated from the capital stabilization fund. Public safety dispatch, radio hardware, $200,000. The Ryan Road Finn School cafeteria renovations, $175,000. The police department animal control facility for $395,000, the total of which is $770,000. We have a motion of finance?
Make a motion.
Second?
Second.
All right. The mayor's here for any questions on this one. Any questions for the mayor? Councilor?
I'm just curious if you could describe what $395,000 for an animal control facility gets us.
Certainly. And this is an estimate. This is an estimate that Central Services has put together that includes not only, basically includes design, hiring a designer to help us with design, site selection, as well as then the bid document preparation and then construction. And so several years ago, the councilors may know that we moved away from a contract. We used to contract our animal control officer, and it was basically a single contract, and that contract paid for the, covered the animal control officer, and the animal control officer was responsible for having a kennel as part of that process. That person retired, and the kennel itself, the owner of that kennel, who was the aunt of that person, also retired, and so we moved to a more traditional municipal animal control officer system. The police department now has an animal control officer who's on their staff. She also does animal inspections for the health department. And one of our first tasks was trying to identify a place. So under Mass General law, when an animal control officer picks up a stray dog, or there's a dog suspected of rabies, or if there's an animal that's involved in any kind of a criminal case, or someone's arrested and they have an animal, we're required to basically kennel them, have a facility to kennel them. And there's very specific guidelines, health and safety guidelines, around how that kennel is constructed and the way the features of the kennel and drainage and everything. And so as an intermediary step, we entered into an intermunicipal agreement on a short-term basis to be able to use, have access to Amherst's animal control kennel. But that has been, it's been a good intermediate solution as we look at what we were going to do here in Northampton. But it's not very efficient in, to have our animal control officer having to drive back and forth to Amherst, not only to bring dogs there, to retrieve dogs, but then also to go and care for the dogs. So we're a city that's large enough that we do have, you know, from time to time our animal control officer may have as many as five to six dogs that are being kenneled at one time while we're either trying to identify an owner or resolve a case or there's a rabies test being done. And so we're looking to locate and construct a facility here in Northampton. And we are working, looking at identifying sites either on city land, state land, or some other alternative. We're obviously trying to avoid having to do this on private land or purchase private land. We've been touring other facilities. Belchertown just built one. Southwick just recently built one. And so we've been touring them. It's basically it's not an adoption center. It's literally a building that houses, you know, kennels. They have to have drains in every one. There has to be, you know, running water. There has to be heat. There has to be washing facilities, et cetera. And there has to be an area that's quarantined. There also has to be outdoor kenneled runs as well. So we've created this budget as a potential capital budget, and we're beginning that process.
Thank you. Councilor O'Donnell, you have a question.
Is it conceivable that once we have a shiny new facility, we might provide it to other communities who need
it? It's something that we're looking at. I've actually had some discussions with the Council of Governments, who's actually in the process, after our discussions, of doing a survey to Hampshire County communities. Obviously, Belchertown and Amherst, two of the larger Hampshire County communities, have one. And then some of the other communities in Hampshire County have other either kennels or arrangements. In Hamden County, they tend to use the O'Connor Animal Shelter in Springfield as their kennel. They're sort of set up to do that. We don't have a large veterinary clinic or adoption clinic. None of our local vets have the facilities to do that. And so we're definitely going to explore those possibilities. Our primary concern right now, though, is to try to meet Northampton's needs, and then we can explore other possible regional options.
Yeah.
Yes. I think before, didn't we at the animal control officer deal with Mrs. White in West Stanton, and she rented off from her because she bred dogs and so forth?
That is correct. Yes. That was an arrangement that was made by Nancy.
Right, that was coming out of her own paycheck where she paid to go ahead and bring the animals.
That is correct. And we did visit and discuss with Mrs. White, and the police visited with her. And it's not something that she wanted to continue doing. And frankly, the facility doesn't quite meet the codes that we were looking for it to meet.
She had passed away, mm-hmm. and Nancy had retired.
Exactly.
But I don't think there is a facility in West Stanton right now.
Yeah, yeah. Again, if you're a small, small rural community, my sense is they probably don't have a facility. The animal control officer probably has a kennel at their house or something. You know, it's probably done on a very, but for a city our size with the number of dogs that we have, we really need. And some of you have, you know, if you follow the Northampton Police Department on Facebook, you know that frequently, and my finance director went gaga over one of those dogs recently. somebody else got it. She actually was wanting to adopt one of them that she saw on Facebook. But yeah, they're frequently looking for dogs, they're looking for owners to dogs or finding dogs. And so it actually is a fairly important and busy part of our public safety.
How much land would we need, Mayor, to actually construct a building?
We're not thinking this is going to be a large area. I think one of the concerns we want to look at is the location, because obviously we would like it to be somewhat remote. Obviously, it's not something you would put in a residential neighborhood. And it's not a place that the public is going to go to. That's not how we work. If somebody wants to retrieve a dog that's been lost, our ACO meets them at the police station to make that return dogs. So we're looking at, it doesn't have to be a large area of land. And we're trying to look at land that the city already owns or other parcels that may be, again, fit those descriptions. We were also talking a little bit, looking at some state land as well.
Just going to mention
that. That might be available as well. So we're trying to search all possible options. But we do need to engage a designer to help us. And so part of this project will be to do that.
Any other questions on this one? Hearing none, then all in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Great. Thank you. Again, upon the recommendation of the mayor, this is 17271. In order to authorize appropriation of $517,000 from receipts reserved for appropriation for parking capital project, it orders that pursuant to the FY 18 to 22 capital programs, the following projects be appropriated from receipts reserved for appropriation for parking. EJ Gear Garage Maintenance, $127,000. Parking equipment, a litter vacuum for $50,000. Roundhouse lot improvements for $230,000. And planning and sustainability wayfinding sign certification, $110,000, for a total of $517,000. Do we have a motion to finance?
Make a motion.
Second.
All right. Discussion, questions for the mayor? Hearing no questions. All in favor of that positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Again, upon the recommendation of the mayor, this is 17272, in order to authorize the borrowing of $1,630,000 for the cost of engineering and construction of a spillway at the Ryan Reservoir. Order that the sum of $1,630,000 is appropriated for the cost of engineering at Ryan Reservoir and construction of a spillway repairs, including the payment of costs incidental or related thereto. And to meet such appropriation, the treasurer, with the approval of the mayor, is authorized to borrow $1,630,000 under Mass General Law 44, subsection 7, or pursuant to any other enabling authority, and to issue bonds or notes of the city therefore, and the mayor is authorized to take any other action necessary to carry out this project. Any premium received by the city upon the sale of any bonds or notes approved by this vote, less any premium applied to the payment of the costs of issuance of such bonds or notes, may be applied to the payment of costs approved by this vote in accordance with Chapter 44, Section 20 of the General Laws, hereby reducing the amount authorized to be borrowed to pay such costs by like amount. We have a motion in finance.
Second.
And we've been ordered to do this one, as I recall.
Well, these are some of the ones that we discussed, not so much on the evening of the capital improvement plan, but as part of the water and sewer discussion of capital projects when the director, LaScaglia, was here. And they have laid out a multi-year plan to address some of the capital needs at our reservoirs, our various reservoirs, Ryan, West Whately, and Mountain Street. And they've noted some deficiencies, particularly in the spillways that need to be fixed. So this first phase would focus on doing engineering for the Ryan reservoir repairs, and then half of the construction. And then we've kind of phased in, you know, the remaining construction there. Next year will be the remaining 50% construction, then working on the West Whately engineering and sort of knocking them off, you know, one at a time. And for those of you who are Rachel Maddow fans and may have noted, there was a story she was following about a spillway in California that the spillway was sort of, before people's eyes, was slowly falling apart, and big chunks of concrete were coming out as the water was starting to sort of breach it. That's an example. We don't have them as large as that one in California, but all of our reservoirs have those spillways in cases where the water level needs to have a way to leave in an orderly fashion. And so these spillways are inspected on a regular basis for integrity. And so we know that we need to make some repairs at these three reservoir spillways.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Lamar?
Yes, Mayor, if I can recall, I think an order had come to City Council in regards to that site area at the Ryan Reservoir, and I think it was Mr. Skibisky that came in to sell property on the left side of the Ryan Reservoir.
Okay.
And there was a big controversy over that. But Ned Huntley had talked about getting the property because of logging. Hmm. And we'd make money on that logging. Is there an update? I've never heard anything more about that.
Well, we do have, I'm not really prepared to talk about that tonight, but we do have logging accounts for all of our reservoir lands, protection lands, and we have been involved in a fairly substantial logging program in recent years, where we've hired a conservation forester. You may remember a couple of years ago, that one kind of came to you, came, there were some concerns about clear cutting and other activities that were happening. And so we actually had our forester come in, and we do have a multi-year plan. And part of the part of that is selling that timber, and we do have an account for timber revenues. So I can get
Ned had mentioned that,
yeah,
and something
can,
that it would help pay.
Yes.
For any type of work that had to be done there.
Yeah, but that's that would be work that's done on the land itself. We did do some clearing of land, hiring foresters to clear land, and then we sell some of the timber. So usually when we get an estimate to buy land, we typically get not only a market value of the property, but then we also get a timber estimate of what the value of the timber is. So we can look in the account to see where it is and give you an update on that, but we clearly are actively, and even if you go up there today, particularly near the water treatment plant on that side, there's you can see that there's active timber operations going on. So yep.
Very good. Councilor.
Mayor, so I'm new to this. So we're borrowing $1.6 million. For how long? And, I mean, so we, how do we put that together?
Well, we,
real
we,
quick and easy for
me. We work with a financial firm that actually works with us. They are experts in not only, you know, the laws around bonding and borrowing authorizations. They also work with us to work with the credit rating agencies to go through our actual rating to get our rating updated every year. And then they actually sell the bonds for us on the open market. Typically what Mass General Law, there are rules about how long you can borrow for depending on what the asset is. So I'm assuming with these, we're probably gonna do like a 10 to 15 year time frame. So often when the actual borrowings happen, the bonds will sometimes have different, you know, for vehicles, for example, we're not going to obviously not going to borrow for 20 years. For school buildings, we've typically done 20. They've changed the law. You can do 30 now. But obviously the longer you borrow, the more interest you're going to pay over time. So an asset like this, is probably going to be more in the 15 to 20 year range, as opposed to trucks or something smaller, or if we had to borrow for, you know, IT related infrastructure, it would probably be more like a 5 year window. But they give us guidance on that, and there's there are regulations that govern that. So that's kind of how we do it.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I noticed we're doing a number of items where we're doing the borrowing.
Yes.
And so are they all going to be in that 10 to 15 year range, or
what happens is we sort of bundle them together, and there's usually a bond offering, and people are buying them sort of they're looking at the bond offerings we have, and they may buy the longer term stuff, they may buy the shorter term stuff. So we're sort of bundling it all, and they're selling it on the, like, literally, you know, being put out on the open municipal bond market with a deadline for bids to be submitted, and bids are submitted, and we sell them. We don't sell them, but our bond council does. Okay. And then literally the treasurer and I get stacks of actual bond certificates that we have to sign, that we sign, and the owners of those certificates get those certificates that are, you know, attesting to the full faith and credit of the city of Northampton. So, and again, we've achieved a very good bond rating, which has given us very favorable interest rates. So, for some of these projects, we'll use some of our stabilization monies, but for some of the larger ones, it makes more sense to borrow, and take advantage of the interest rates.
Thank you. 'Cause that was my question with the others, and
okay.
You can just skip through. Thank you.
Councilor.
Yeah, just building on what Councilor Nash brought up, just out of curiosity, over the, you know, the 5 years of your capital program, is the borrowing you anticipate kind of front loaded because it's a favorable time to do more borrowing now? Is that kind of a fair assessment?
We're definitely going to try to borrow everything that we know we're going to be able to spend, because the other problem that you run into with the borrowing, it, and actually the IRS is getting more and more on top of this. If you go ahead and borrow money, there's an understanding that you need to spend it within a certain amount of time, because they're otherwise there are what are called arbitrage rules, which Dennis can probably explain. I don't understand it, but they but basically you're not allowed to like borrow money through a municipal bond and then put it in the bank and make money off of borrowed money. So we're very careful to look at all the plan at all the projects, and specifically that was one of the issues we're working on with DPW. You're allowed a certain amount of time to make the project happen, but we're not going to borrow for the entire plan now, knowing that we're not going to be able to construct it all. But definitely we're looking to do as much as we can and bundle it together, and try to take advantage of favorable rates for sure, but only in a capacity that we can actually carry out the projects.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah.
Any other questions on that one? Hearing none, then all in favor of a positive recommendation of finance, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Again, upon the recommendation of the mayor, this is 17.273, in order to authorize borrowing of $250,000 for the cost of repairs to the Audubon Road water tank. Order that the sum of $250,000 is appropriate for the cost of the Audubon Road water tank repairs, including the payment of costs incidental and related thereto, that to meet such appropriation, the treasurer, with the approval of the mayor, is authorized to borrow $250,000 under Mass General Law Section 44, Subsection 8, or pursuant to any other enabling authority, and to issue bonds or notes of the city therefore, and the mayor is authorized to take any other action necessary to carry out this project. Any premium received by the city upon sale of any bonds or notes approved by this vote, less any such premium applied to the payment of the costs of issuance of such bonds or notes, may be applied to the payment of costs approved by this vote in accordance with Chapter 44, Section 20 of the General Laws, hereby reducing the amount authorized to be borrowed to pay such costs by like amount. We have a motion, finance.
Make a motion.
Second. Any questions on this one? This is to repair a water tank. Hearing none, all in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Incidentally, again, upon the recommendation of the mayor, this is 17.274, to authorize the borrowing of $250,000 for the rehabilitation and replacement of the city's primary water main transmission lines. Order that the sum of $250,000 appropriate for the cost of engineering construction work related to the rehabilitation and replacement of the city's primary water main transmission lines, including the payment of costs incidental or related thereto, to meet such appropriation, the treasurer, with the approval of the mayor, is authorized to borrow $250,000 under Mass General Law Section 44, Subsection 8, or pursuant to any other enabling authority, and to issue bonds or notes of the city therefore, the mayor is authorized to take any other action necessary to carry out the project. Any premium received by the city for the sale of the bonds, notes approved by this vote, less any such premium applied to the payment of the costs of the issuance of the bonds or notes, may be applied to the payment of the costs approved by this vote in accordance with Chapter 44, Section 20 of the General Laws, thereby reducing the amount authorized to be borrowed to pay such costs and like amount. Do we have a motion? Second?
Second.
Any questions on this one? Hearing none, all in favor of a positive recommendation finance, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? No. On the recommendation of the mayor, this is 17.275, in order to authorize appropriation from the Water Enterprise Stabilization Funds for various water department program expenditures. Order that pursuant to the FY18-22 Capital Improvements Program, the following capital projects be appropriated from the Water Enterprise Stabilization Fund. Water Treatment Plant Storage Building, $90,000. Water Treatment System Building Roof and Masonry Repairs, $100,000. Water Department Vehicle Replacements, $326,100, for a total expenditure of $516,100. A motion.
Make a motion.
Second?
Second.
Any questions on this one for the mayor? Councilor Bartsch?
Yeah, Mayor. In the Water Department Vehicle Replacements, mm-hmm. $326,100. Mm-hmm. What kind of a vehicle is that?
Yeah, it's actually multiple.
It's mints.
The,
plural.
Yeah. Okay.
So it is actually a, we are replacing a 2005 Ford Ranger vehicle and upgrading that to an F-150 4x4 pickup. We are then replacing a, we're purchasing a skid steer, which would be something used for, you know, more for actual construction projects. We are also adding a mini excavator, which is a smaller, smaller version of the giant excavators we have for getting into tighter spaces and tighter jobs. And then we are replacing a 2004 Ford F-450 with a newer model, a 7400 International Utility. One of the things I want to commend Director LaScaglia, and she included it in the capital program, is she, since becoming director, she's really gone through every vehicle in the department and tried to replicate what our police and fire departments have done, which is to try to create a replacement schedule based on the age and the mileage, so that there's sort of a predictable replacement every few years, so that we're not letting the entire fleet get old and in disrepair. And so she sort of put together a very very orderly replacement schedule, and so this is what they've identified for the water department for this year.
I know you had brought it up at the hearing, but because this is being videoed, I thought it was important that people realize exactly where that money's going.
Definitely. Thank you, Councilor.
Any other questions on the water department deals? Hearing none. All in favor of a positive recommendation?
Aye.
Aye.
Say aye. This is 17.267, an order to authorize a borrowing of $500,000 for street resurfacing. Order that the sum of $500,000 is appropriated to pay the cost of street resurfacing in the city, including the payment of costs incidental or related thereto. To meet such appropriation, the treasurer, with the approval of the mayor, is authorized to borrow $500,000 under Mass General Law Section 44, Subsection 7, or pursuant to any other enabling authority, issue bonds or notes of the city. Therefore, the mayor is authorized to take any other action necessary to carry out this project. Any premium received by the city for the sale of any bonds or notes approved by the authority, thus any such premium applied to the payment of the cost of the issuance of such bonds or notes, be applied to the payment of the cost approved by this vote in accordance with Chapter 44, Section 20 of the General Laws, hereby reducing the amount authorized to be borrowed to pay such costs by like amount. Further ordered that the city treasurer is authorized to file an application with the appropriate officials of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts to qualify under Chapter 44A of the General Laws any or all bonds of the city authorized by this council as of the date hereof, and to provide such information and execute such documents as such officials of the Commonwealth may require in connection therewith. Have a motion?
Make a motion.
Second.
Second. And did everybody get the paving schedule today via email? Very aggressive, and it'll make a lot of our constituents very happy that their roads are getting fixed. Questions for the mayor? This is a generally popular thing, fixing the roads. Hearing none. All in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Great. Okay, this is 27277, an order to authorize the borrowing of $755,000 to purchase vehicles for the Department of Public Works. Order that the sum of $755,000 is appropriated for the cost of purchasing vehicles for the Department of Public Works, including the payment of costs incidental or related to thereto. That to meet such appropriation, the treasurer, with the approval of the mayor, is authorized to borrow $755,000 under Mass General Law Section 44, Subsection 7, or pursuant to any other enabling authority, to issue bonds or notes of the city. Therefore, the mayor is authorized to take any other action necessary to carry out this project. Any premium received by the city upon the sale of any bonds or notes approved by this vote, unless any premium applied to the payment of cost of the issuance of such bonds or notes, may be applied to the payment of the cost approved by this vote in accordance with Chapter 44, Section 20, the General Laws, thereby reducing the amount authorized to be borrowed to pay such costs by like amount. Further order that the city treasurer is authorized to file an application with the appropriate officials of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts to qualify under Chapter 44A of the general laws, any and all bonds of the city authorized by this council as of the date hereof, to provide such information and execute such documents as officials of the Commonwealth may require connection therewith. Do we have a motion?
Make a motion.
Second. Any questions from the mayor on this one?
So, Mayor, maybe you can explain this one at $755,000 plus what you just explained about the water department with
Sure. So, again, in the capital improvement program, Director LaScaglia has identified these are general fund vehicle replacements, and I can go through them quickly. In one case, a 1981 grader is being replaced with a new John Deere grader. That's for the streets department. In one case, a 2006 skid steer is being replaced with a newer skid steer, an MCT125C. We have a 1997 F350 4x4 utility that's being upgraded to a newer F350. We have a 1984 dump truck that's being replaced with a Ford F550 4x4 dump truck with a sander. We have a 1992 F350 pickup that's being replaced with again, similar Ford F550 4x4 with a dump bed on the back. We are replacing a vibratory roller made by the Wacker Company, aptly named, that is worn out with a new vibratory roller. And then we're replacing a 2005. Then we're replacing a 1998 Stowe static roller with a newer model vibratory roller. We are also replacing a 1996 F350 with a newer Ford F350. That's for the Parks and Cemetery Division. And then we're replacing a 2002 Ford Ranger that the engineering division is using, and we are replacing that with a Ford Transit Connect. So again, these are all vehicles, many from the previous century that we are that we are replacing, and in some cases, vehicles that are no longer manufactured, like the Ford Ranger, for example, not one of the safer vehicles on the road either. So we're replacing that with sort of newer models.
Thank you for that communication, Mayor.
And so that all totals up.
I think I saw that grader plowing my street just a few weeks ago.
You may have.
Yeah, it is old. It looks like we're doing a lot of catch-up here around our vehicles. I mean, just based on all of those Reagan and Clinton vehicles.
We are. Again, we're trying to invest, and we also find, obviously, that older vehicles also require more maintenance, and they're off the road more. Like that grader that you see in your neighborhood, when that goes down, that which it has many times, it's difficult to find parts for, and that's the one that is sort of our workhorse, particularly in the downtown, when we're trying to move those big piles of snow.
Especially removing snow.
Exactly. That's why we feel it's important. That's an important piece that we need to make an investment in a more modern one. So it'll eventually, the savings will be in the maintenance costs of not having to do the kind of maintenance and welding the thing back together.
Councilor Donnelly, you got a
question? Can I just ask what's maybe a naive question, but two sets of vehicles, one we are borrowing for, and the previous one for the water department, we're just paying for out of stabilization funds. I'm just elucidate the difference.
Because we're trying to balance out our borrowing. We're in cases where we've built up stabilization. If you look in the preamble to the capital improvement program, we talk about our strategy for capital stabilization funds, and that we're trying to
in the early years, we were trying to build them up to a certain level, and then we would start to actually draw from them to pay for some capital projects. So for vehicles, you know, for smaller vehicles, you know, where you're only going to borrow for 5 years, if we've got the cash in our stabilization, we're going to just go ahead and buy them. Yeah. So I think that's what you're seeing there.
Okay.
Yep.
Great. And Councilor Bidwell, do you have a question?
Just as the replacing older vehicles with new means less maintenance intensive, I assume there's a considerable improvement in fuel efficiency.
That's true, definitely.
And I would, to the extent you or any of us are called upon to explain this expenditure on new vehicles, I mean that's part of it too. I imagine that's a significant improvement over the years.
Definitely, there have been strides in some of those larger vehicles in gas efficiency. Yeah, I mean there are some advantages to the older vehicles. That you know, the old saying, they don't make them like they used to. I mean, I was talking to Mr. Antosh, who's one of our top maintenance people, and they find that a lot of the trucks come through now, the Fords and stuff come through, and we're doing our own sort of treatment of them, rust treatment of them, because they find that they're coming through the from the factory, and they're not quite made the way they were, 20 or 30 years ago. So even though they're new, we still do some extra work on them to make them last. But yeah, generally the equipment, the heated cabs, the technology, and the fuel efficiency is always better. So
any more questions on this one? Then in finance, all in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
This is 17278, an order to authorize borrowing of $375,000 for the Clement Street Bridge project. Order that the sum of $375,000 is appropriated for the cost of the Clement Street Bridge project, including the payment of costs incidental or related thereto, and to meet the appropriation, the treasurer, with the approval of the mayor, is authorized to borrow $375,000 under Mass General Law Section 44, subsection 7, pursuant to any other enabling authority, and to issue bonds or notes of the city. Therefore, that the mayor is authorized to take any other action necessary to carry out this project. Any premium received by the city upon the sale of any bonds or notes approved by this vote, unless any such premium applied to the payment of the costs of the issuance of such bonds or notes, may be applied to the payment of the cost approved by this vote in accordance with Chapter 44, Section 20 of the General Laws, thereby reducing the amount authorized to be borrowed to pay such costs by like amount. Further order, the city treasurer is authorized to file an application with the appropriate officials of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts to qualify under Chapter 44A of the General Laws any and all bonds of the city authorized by this council as of the date hereof, and to provide such information and execute such documents as officials of the Commonwealth may require in connection herewith. Do we have a motion on this one? Second. Any questions for the mayor on this one? Sure. Councilor.
Just wondering, what kind of life extension of the bridge does this get us? It needs a lot of work, and I know there are different options for what we could spend on. I'm wondering, which option did you choose, and what does this represent?
So you may recall from a previous capital program that we did, the council approved spending, I think it was about $50,000, to hire a structural engineer to actually figure out that issue and give us some plans. And so out of that came the report, and they did give us some options. But as we've worked through this, and they have gone through it, we're actually, the engineers are feeling like that we're going to be able to do with this sort of intermediate solution, that intermediate meaning as opposed to replacing the whole bridge, that we are going to be able to extend the life of the bridge significantly longer than we thought. They are, again, they're still going to be doing some of the final design work, but our hope is that we can extend it another, 5-10 years without being bad. I mean, the bridge, Councilor Murphy knows the bridge. It's a bridge that would be very difficult to build today. It's a one-lane bridge. It's on a river. It's a one-lane, and so replacing that bridge is going to be significantly expensive. And we've talked to MassDOT about it. And it's pretty low on their bridge replacement priority list. So, and for those counselors who've met with the neighborhood and understand how beloved that bridge is and what an important kind of transportation network it provides, we feel that this is the best investment to try to extend the life of it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, thank you. Yeah, and I agree. I've heard from that neighborhood in Bay State.
Yep.
But it's also, as you point out, it's a connector. If it weren't there,
yes,
I see some problems as a result of that.
And it was closed briefly.
It was closed, yeah.
But there was an inspection that found that it was, 3,000 vehicles a day, as the as our capital program points out. So it does carry significant traffic. So.
And when they're not on that bridge, they go other places and congest other spots. Councilor Bidwell.
So what would be the time frame for this project? Are you imagining?
The time frame would be, we would, they would have to move forward with the, because of the expense of the project, we'd have to do, go out to bid for probably construction services and select the contractor to do it. And then they would move forward with it. I don't have an exact construction timeline. But it's going under the bridge, and there's some repairs that have to be made. They also are talking about reinforcing some of the trussing that's there already, that they believe will help extend the integrity of it as well. So that's what the engineer, I can, for those who are interested, I can send you a copy of the engineering report.
But there's no bridge closure, extended bridge closure involved?
There may need to be some closure for the construction period, and obviously we would alert people to that. But I'm not thinking it's going to be like 6 months or something like that. We're hopeful that it's not going to be significant. There will also have to be permits, probably from the Conservation Commission, and because they'll be operating over a body of water. So there'll be some permitting involved as well. So certainly when we move forward with that, we'll be alerting. I know you have constituents who use it a lot, and obviously Councillor Murphy has constituents, as do other councillors.
Mm-hmm. Just a comment. It's ironic that under the stimulus package by President Obama, there were a number of bridge redevelopments. There were primary and tertiary, secondary and tertiaries, but it's based on regions and community. I just witnessed a $2 million complete bridge rebuild for two lanes to a dead end road, to a road that's been discontinued.
That's called a bridge to nowhere.
If I have property on the other side of that,
the governor of Alaska.
Yeah, but the fact is that, because of the way we subsidize these things, this one's clearly a critical transportation feature in the city. The problem is, of course, even if they did use the stimulus money to do it, it would not be that bridge. They would demolish that bridge completely because it doesn't conform with the current standards for engineering, and that would be a loss too, because it's actually, as you point out, the bridge has sentimental value to a lot of people as well. It's an iconic bridge. Mm-hmm. But whatever we can do to prolong it, mm-hmm, is all for the better, I presume.
And replacing it would change the character of the whole neighborhood. I mean, it would just be a devastating change.
If we were a two-lane bridge, suddenly traffic.
Oh, that would be 3,000 cars a day.
Yeah.
Councilor?
Yes, Mayor, last time when we worked on the bridge, how long was that put off to the side where people couldn't use it?
It was like 6 months for 3 days' work.
Yeah,
it was ridiculous.
What basically happened was there was a bridge collapse in Minnesota,
right,
which some of you may remember, and suddenly bridge inspectors all over the country, yes, said, we better go check our files of any bridges that failed an inspection or whatever, and they fanned out across the Commonwealth, closing bridges, inspecting and then closing bridges. And so Clement Street was one of the ones shortly after that got closed. I think I'm getting that right.
Do you remember how long it was closed?
We think it was about 6 months.
6 months. And it's 3 days to rectify the problem.
Yes.
So it closed for an inordinately long time for a quick fix.
It does have.
As I recall, They finished it on Friday, but they left the equipment on the bridge for a three-day weekend before they took it off. So as insult to injury, the work was done, but then they didn't clear the bridge for three more days because it was a holiday weekend, so.
And there were businesses that were impacted.
We were very unhappy.
Because it did, yeah.
So, any other questions on this one?
No.
Hearing none, all in favor of positive recommendation?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. The next one is 17279, in order to authorize the appropriation from the mayor's payment in lieu of taxes programs to fund cardiac monitors for the fire department. Order that pursuant to the 2018 to 22 capital improvements program that $74,500 be appropriated from the mayor's payment in lieu of taxes program to fund the purchase of 12 lead cardiac monitors for the fire department. Motion.
Make a motion.
Second.
Second.
Yeah, please vote for this one because I think I'm going to need one by the time. Questions for the mayor?
Counselor.
Mayor, on here it says that we are looking at 12 lead cardiac monitors. What is the lifespan for a cardiac monitor?
Well, I'm going to have to look that up because I can't tell you. I have a lot of interesting facts in my head. That's not one that I can recall.
And it's they're
we'll
saying
look at
for
the
12 of them at $74,500.
Yeah.
So round that off, it's probably what per cardiac monitor about $6,700 a piece. About
so,
that.
So just to go ahead to read directly from the fire rescue. The fire rescue narrative on this. The project would replace our two oldest 12 lead cardiac monitors. These monitors are essential equipment for our ambulance crews. They provide information to the medics that help dictate treatment for cardiac related emergencies. We purchased these two monitors when we started our ambulance service over 10 years ago. They have been cycled over time to our backup apparatus. These monitors are at the end of their 12-year life expectancy.
Yeah, thank you.
So it's a 12-year life expectancy. And so as we buy new ambulances and, you know, we're trying to stay within that life cycle, they're wanting to add these additional ones. Okay?
Councilor, you did.
Yeah, you've clarified it. It's two monitors,
right.
Not 12 monitors.
Yeah, I think 12 lead.
They have 12 lead.
Yeah, 12.
I even tried Googling it earlier.
Yeah.
I don't.
What is this thing?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So,
I believe
two monitors.
It was confusing.
Exactly.
Two monitors. Yeah. 12 lead.
But when you want a cardiac monitor, you want it to work.
Well, yes.
I hope so.
You don't want the 13-year-old.
You don't want the old one that they got to
exactly.
Get.
Exactly.
Just need cardiac see. Monitors for your cardiac monitors.
Yes.
Counselor.
How much money is in the pilot fund?
Well, the particular fund that we are drawing from, I believe, was at $112,000. We were trying to find a project that was large enough and that sort of fit within the parameters of the public safety, public works fund. And then our plan was to try to use the excess and then apply it to some additional funds we got to try to fund another project. We're anticipating that we'll have an additional $110,000 this coming in this year that we would apply to projects moving forward.
During the year or wait till next year's?
We would probably bundle it for next year's plan as well. This just happened to be a project that was the sort of the right amount that sort of seemed to use a good chunk of it, and it was a public safety. Some of it's from Cooley Dickinson, some of it is from Smith College. Yeah.
Councilor Barge, did that answer your question?
So what is the total, actual total, Mayor, that we have received on the payment in lieu of taxes?
So,
it's 112
received
from last year.
$110 has come in so far as we're working in for the 2018 program. So,
are we going to do that again? Go after?
Well, it's what I need to explain is those were gifts. I requested a voluntary pilot participation. And those two institutions said that they did not want to participate in the pilot program and did not want to call it pilot. but that they would make gifts, annual gifts. They committed to 3 years of annual gifts. In the case of Smith, $100,000 a year for 3 years. In the case of Cooley, $10,000 a year for 3 years. And so last April, they sent us the first installment. We're getting the other installment. And then presumably there would be a third installment. So we are trying to allocate that into the capital plan.
Thank you.
Yep. Okay. Yeah, so if you look ahead into the FY19 year of the five-year plan, you'll see that we're hoping to allocate about $140,000 towards new turnout gear for the fire department.
Okay.
And that's going to be using some of what's left over for this year plus next year. And that's how we're going to apply it.
Thank you.
Councilor?
Just a question about that. These are your earmarks. These are not the earmarks as stipulated by the donor.
No.
Thank you.
I'm just trying to stay true to when I did create the pilot program, we were saying that the 25% was because it would be covering costs like public works, fire, police. So
services that these nonprofits would enjoy
that they do receive benefit from. Yes, indeed. So I was trying to stay true to the spirit of that, and not use it for areas in that area. Yeah.
Any more questions on this one in finance? Hearing none. All in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Excellent. Next is 17280, in order to authorize the appropriation of $35,200 to fund the purchase of wide area network switches for the city's fiber loop, ordered that pursuant to the FY18-22 capital program, $35,200 be appropriated from the PEG access and cable related fund to fund the purchase of wide area network switches to maintain the city's fiber loop. You have a motion to finance?
Make a motion.
Second. All right. Any questions on this one? Hearing none, all in favor of positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? The next one is 17281. In order to authorize appropriation of $10,000 from a gift fund to be used for playground equipment at the Leeds and Bridge Street Elementary Schools, order that pursuant to the FY18-22 capital improvement program, that $10,000 be appropriated from a gift made to the city by DA Sullivan to partially fund early childhood playground equipment at the Leeds Elementary School and Bridge Street Elementary School. Motion?
Make a motion.
Second.
Second.
Questions for the mayor?
Yes. DA Sullivan, is that the same company that donated the table?
Yes, actually. Last year they made a $10,000 donation, and we applied it towards the desks. And this year Mr. Sullivan contacted us and said that they wanted to make an additional $10,000, and we discussed with them various projects that we were, smaller kind of projects we were looking at, and we discussed this playground equipment, and they said that would be something they would want to apply that towards. So you approved a portion of the playground money in the earlier free cash order, and this would help supplement that. So thank you again to DA Sullivan.
Councilor.
Well, we certainly appreciate their generosity. Do you know a little bit more what the plans are at the two schools for that equipment? And this is for the, certainly, at Bridge, it looks like the same thing at Leeds, for the kindergarten playground, or actually both those schools now have preschools, so the kindergarten and preschool.
That's, yeah.
And Leeds never had any equipment.
Right, so this is a new program for them,
exactly.
The preschool. So
I'll give you that before. So the request is to install playground equipment that is age appropriate to preschool age students at two schools that house preschool programs, Bridge and Leeds. There is currently playground equipment at both schools, but it's rated for elementary school children ages 5 and over. We need to have equipment for students under age 5. We recently had our preschool programs reviewed by the state. The main concern that surfaced was the inappropriateness of the playground equipment. And there have been some student accidents on the playground that may have been prevented if it was more age appropriate. So that's to purchase more preschool level equipment at those two schools.
Great, thank
Any other questions on the playground equipment? Hearing none, all in favor of a positive recommendation of finance, please say aye.
Aye.
Next is 17282, an order to authorize borrowing of $400,000 for window replacement at the Forbes Library. Order that the sum of $400,000 is appropriated for the cost of window replacement and or renovation at the Forbes Library, including the payment of costs incidental or related thereto. That to meet such appropriation, the treasurer or the approval of the mayor is authorized to borrow $400,000 under Mass General Law, Chapter 44, Subsection 7, or pursuant to any other enabling authority, and issue bonds or notes of the city. Therefore, the mayor is authorized to take any other action necessary to carry out this project. Any premium received by the city upon the sale of any bonds or notes approved by this vote, less any premium applied to the payment of the costs of the issuance of the bonds or notes, may be applied to the payment of the cost approved by the vote in accordance with Chapter 44, Section 20 of the General Laws, thereby reducing the amount authorized to be borrowed to pay such costs by like amount. We have a motion for
this. Motion.
Second. Questions on this one? This group of windows is basically for the collection.
This is actually for all of the windows. This is for all of the windows in the library. And we are doing a, we may phase the construction to be just the first set of windows being the ones where we're doing the next order, which is the special collections room, if it has to be phased over two seasons. But the 400,000 is, you may remember in last year's capital budget items, you approved, I think it was $50,000 to do the design and architectural services to study what the solution was for the windows. It turns out we're not going to replace them. We're actually going to have them rebuilt and made more weather resistant. And so that's going to be a meticulous task because there's a lot of windows in that building. And so this is the funding that will allow us to do that.
And those windows would have been custom made for that building when it was constructed.
Those are the original buildings, yeah, yes.
It's in the architectural districts.
Yep. So
there was a lot of discussion about that. Councillor.
So then these windows are being restored just as are they being improved with glazing?
Yes. And I believe an energy pane. If you've ever seen, you know, when this old house does a Victorian sometimes, right. Then rather than replacing them, they literally have a person that rebuilds each window, right, and adds an energy pane and reglazes, and then they go and, you know, fill the pockets in and add more modern mechanical fixtures to the window.
It's a very expensive process in order to maintain the integrity of the lights of the windows and the appearance of the windows, so it's much more expensive than if you are actually replacing them.
Mm-hmm. Well, actually, so the architectural costs, the cost to do the retrofitted option was actually slightly less,
really,
than buying either than having Pella or Marvin manufacture
yeah,
sort of new historic looking windows. It actually turned out to be less to reuse the old windows. Slightly, very slightly less.
And probably not comparably efficient though, I would imagine.
Possibly not.
So there may be an offset there.
There may be, but we hired Jones Whitsitt Architects. We worked included the library staff and maintenance staff in the process, and this is what we've selected. Obviously, it's a historic building. Obviously, it's part of the Central Business Architecture District, and so anytime you touch anything with windows, there would be scrutiny of what any new window would look like.
Well, the reason I ask is I think it's important to emphasize the amount of the integrity and thought that went into the investment in these windows, which is significant.
Yes.
And that and we in upholding our condition of the trust.
Mm-hmm.
So
yep.
It was worth noting.
Yes, definitely.
Any other questions on the windows? Hearing none, all in favor of a positive recommendation?
Aye.
Say aye. 17-283, in order to authorize a borrowing of $200,000 for the cost of an HVAC system and installation of improvements at Four of Library. And this is the one that's for the collections. Ordered that the sum of $200,000 is appropriated for the cost of HVAC system installation and improvements at Four of Library, including the payment of costs incidental or related thereto, that to meet such appropriation, the treasurer, with the approval of the mayor, is authorized to borrow $200,000 under Mass General Law Section 44, Subsection 7, or pursuant to any other enabling authority, and to issue bonds or notes of the city therefore, that the mayor is authorized to take any other action necessary to carry out the project. Any premium received by the city upon the sale of any bonds or notes approved by this vote, lest any premium applied to the payment of the cost of the issuance of such bonds or notes may be applied to the payment of costs approved by this vote in accordance with Chapter 44, Section 20, General Laws, thereby reducing the amount authorized to be borrowed to pay such costs by like amount. Do we have a motion?
Make a motion.
Second. Any questions on this one for the mayor? And again, this is for the collections room, correct?
Exactly. Yep, it's for the special collections room. Coolidge Library, where they need to have quality, you know, special air temperatures to keep those
get the humidity out of the
historic documents, correct.
Any other questions on this one? All in favor? Oh, Councilor.
Quick question. I know this doesn't fall into the realm of public safety or the other things that you've looked at for the pilot program, but I'm just wondering about the possibility of considering pilot funds for something for Forbes Library, since we're considering all these different things for Forbes, just because it does have a direct relationship to Smith College in terms of student use and things like that. So I'm just wondering if that's a possibility for the future.
Again, you know, it's a multi-million dollar capital plan, and we could apply it to lots of different places, but when I laid out the pilot program, I was pretty clear what we would use it for, and it's what I told them. The areas that I said I would use the funds for is what I told them I would use it for, so I'm trying to stay true to that. So that, I guess that would be my response. Yeah.
Any more questions on the library? Thank you. Hearing none, all in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Excellent. Next is 17-284. In order to authorize reprogramming of $10,738 to partially fund fire alarm and smoke detector systems and upgrades at Forbes Library. Order that pursuant to the FY18 to 22 capital improvements plans, the $10,738 be reprogrammed from Forbes Library handicapped access to pay for funding an upgrade to the fire alarm and smoke detector system at Forbes Library. Do we have a motion?
Make a motion.
Second.
And again, I think this is money that was left over from the lift, I think, that is just reprogramming money.
Leftover monies from the elevator project, and then you funded another piece of this project in the free cash order earlier. So.
Any other questions on the reprogram? All right, hearing none, all in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No. All right, the next one is 17-285, in order authorizing the mayor to convey 91 Grove Street to ServiceNet, Inc. Order that whereas in 1998, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, acting through the Division of Capital Access Management and Maintenance, conveyed to the city a former Northampton State Hospital parcel located at 91 Grove Street, shown as parcel 46 on Assessor Map 38A, which parcel is currently used as an emergency shelter known as the Grove Street Inn and operated under lease by ServiceNet. And whereas in 2016, the mayor received authorization from the city council to seek special legislation allowing him to convey the Grove Street parcel to the emergency shelter operator with provisions for reversion to the city should the operator cease operating an emergency shelter. And whereas on August 12, 2016, the governor signed into law Chapter 241 of the Acts of 2016, in which part amended the original Northampton State Hospital legislation to include the following language. Upon the conveyance of the parcel to the city of Northampton may then convey the parcel to a nonprofit operator of an emergency shelter for homeless, provided that the deed shall contain provisions by which the title to the parcel shall revert to the city if the grantee ceases to operate an emergency shelter for the homeless. And so, now therefore it be ordered that the mayor is hereby authorized to convey the property located at 91 Grove Street, Northampton, Mass., to ServiceNet in accordance with the provisions of Chapter 241 of the Acts of 2016 and on other terms and conditions not inconsistent with Chapter 241 as the mayor deems appropriate. No motion on this one.
Make a motion.
Second.
Okay.
I did note there's a Scrivener's error in the last whereas. It says 2106. I think it should be 2016. A little reversal there. Again, I came to you last year for an order allowing me to seek a special act, and we did receive that special act for it and some other state hospital-related properties that we want to do some work with. ServiceNet has been operating the homeless shelter on a lease basis, a $1 a year lease. And we believe this is a better arrangement to just have them own the property outright. It gives them more access to grants to do work on the property. It also allows them to accept gifts and gifts of services on the property. And so when we, as we've been talking about, and frankly, it's removes it from our liability at this point. And when there's a, you know, a problem with a leaky roof or something, it's not something that Central Services is working on, and ServiceNet is happy to be to take that on themselves. So it takes a while to get this through the process, but here we are. And even though this passed in August of last year, there was still a process we had to go through with DCAM to get to this point. We're still working on the other parcels that were state hospital parcels that were also part of the state legislation, and we're hoping to bring something forward related to those once we get that set up with DCAM. Yes.
So once all this does happen, they would buy that home from us?
That is correct. Yeah.
So we would have to go hire somebody to give us what the cost?
No, actually, what we've worked out as part of the legislation is it would be a nominal sale. It would be as the legislation, because basically, in terms of market value of the property, by law, it can only be used as a homeless shelter. It's the only value that the property has. It can only, and if they don't use it as a homeless shelter, it reverts back to the city. So our theory and in our discussions with the legislature, they were fine that we wanted to, I mean, because basically the state owned it and they conveyed it to us for no consideration because they wanted it to remain a homeless shelter. So they are fine with us reconveying it to someone else to let them own and run it as a homeless shelter, provided that it remains a homeless shelter in perpetuity. And if that ceases, and they're really the only operator of a homeless shelter in Northampton. So
they would be responsible for any type of renovations or whatever.
Exactly. Exactly. Yes.
Yeah. So in this case, the use was more important than the value.
Exactly.
Because the intent was to keep it providing the services providing.
Exactly. And Sue Stubbs is excited to do this because there's some grant agencies that that they want to work with to do improvements to the building that they couldn't work with under the current arrangement that they were leasing the building.
Councilor?
Additionally, I think they also are getting some volunteer work or offers for volunteer work that they couldn't, you know, when we owned it, they weren't able to.
It got into some areas of procurement, right, and things like that when there was somebody who wanted to basically said, I want to have my contractor redo your kitchen.
Right.
I'm willing to have my contractor redo the kitchen at the homeless shelter. But we couldn't do that under the way we do procurement and bidding. So it gives them more flexibility.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes. Jack Horner and Ron Skin, they donated a tremendous amount of money of painting the outside of that house twice.
Yes, indeed. Yep.
Councilor Nash?
So once it's in their ownership, they can expand services there? And I mean, it's, I mean, right now, the, because we own the property, expanding the structure and the services that go on there.
They could certainly do that if they wanted to. That's correct. Yeah. I mean, we don't put any limits on the services they offer now. We do work with them.
But has that been a barrier before, maybe, or?
I don't know. I mean, it's a set parcel of land with a set home. I mean, they'll still have to follow zoning regulations and.
But there's no restrictions in terms of it being conveyed from the state hospital to us to them.
Nope. The only restriction that's written into the legislation is it must be used for a homeless shelter. Yeah, that's the one restriction.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions on this one?
And we chose to carry that out by leasing it to a homeless shelter operator. That's how we, you know, did it.
A much cleaner way to do it.
And they would still be eligible for CDBG funds, they'd be eligible for CPA funds, they'd be eligible for a lot of the funding. They would just be doing it as ServiceNet versus the city.
Any other questions? Hearing none, all in favor of a positive recommendation in finance, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And with that, is there any new business to become before us tonight? Hearing none, a motion to adjourn. Finance.
Aye. Second. Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. We move out of recess, and in consideration of Mr. Tebow, who's actually been sitting here throughout this whole thing, I'm wondering if the council would mind moving up item 17.251 for discussion before we go voting on all these orders that we just heard about.
Please.
That is all in favor? Yes. Say aye.
Aye.
Okay. So, this is item 17.251. This is an ordinance to remove the residential incentive overlay from the zoning map, 350-2.1 of said code. Motion's made and seconded. I'm waiting for a second. I'm pointing over here, hoping there was one, but it was
a second.
This is a wishful thinking. So we do have a second. Discussion. Councilor O'Donnell.
Yeah, I can start.
Yeah.
Because I raised questions about it at the last meeting, and my questions are pretty much the same as they were last time, with the exception that I did speak with the solicitor and spoke more with our senior land use planner, Carolyn Misch, about the issue. I think we have a legal question, and then we have a policy question. And my concern, especially at the last meeting, was we weren't addressing the policy question at all, because the assumption was it was a moot point, that the ordinance that we took up then and we have before us now was nothing but a technical ordinance that made a map conform with a previous decision. And that was what I questioned. So with regards to that legal issue, I'll tell you what I believe. I believe it's unclear what the status of the residential incentive overlay district is. I'm willing to be wrong on it. I just haven't, it hasn't been proven to me to my satisfaction that I am wrong. There are three components that establish the residential incentive overlay district. The first is the zoning map, the outline of the border on a map. That's what we would remove tonight. The second are many mentions and references to that overlay district and definitions of all overlay districts in the zoning code, which have not been removed and which would not be removed by the ordinance tonight. And the third is references to the overlay district within the table of use and dimensional regulations for the underlying district, which in this case is the rural residential district. The only thing that has changed of the three is, as Ms. Misch said, a reference to the overlay district within that table of what you can use what you can do in the underlying district, the rural residential district. That reference was removed a couple of years ago. But the other two remain. There's references in the code and it's on the map. So, for example, in the zoning code, the first thing is that the zoning code establishes what overlay districts are. Section 3.3. It reads, an education use district, floodplain district, water supply protection district, and residential incentive development district are superimposed over the other districts shown on the zoning map as recognition of the special conditions which exist in such areas. Where there are conflicts, the regulations for the overlay district supersede the underlying district. The code then goes on to provide for one such overlay district, which is the residential incentive overlay district. It establishes its purpose to encourage affordable housing. It provides that, you know, a minimum of 33% of the total units have to be affordable, and in return, there's a density bonus. And I feel it's supported elsewhere in the code, and I won't get into every single section that I believe backs up that. But as I read it, not being either a lawyer or a planner, as I read it, it's clear what an overlay district is. And there is one in the residential incentive district, and it's depicted on the map. There are three legs to this stool. One has been removed, but the other two have not. So the status of it, to me, is unclear. Now, I did speak to the solicitor, and I can't really represent his firm opinion one way or the other. I think it is because he didn't really give me a firm opinion. He was very thoughtful. He spoke to our senior land use planner, and there were conversations about it. I think it's fair to say that he would agree that there is some murkiness there, that if there really was an intention to remove the whole district, we would have removed all three legs of the stool. But the fact that we didn't is a little problematic. So I'm not going to represent to you that he is taking my viewpoint, but I'm also not going to say that he said I'm totally mistaken. So I think there's some lack of clarity there. Because of that, in my opinion, this is not just a technical ordinance. I think there's a policy question, and that is, do you want the overlay district or not? And I think there are certainly, to acknowledge the other side, there are certainly good arguments for why you would want to eliminate it. You know, as Ms. Mish has said, nothing's been built here since it's been in place. It's been in place for a while. The infrastructure may not support it, supposedly, or I don't know, but that's what I've heard. The market may not support it. Maybe that's why nothing's been built there. From my perspective, I don't see it as a problem. I don't know why we would remove this tool that the planning board can use, even if they don't know they can use it. I don't understand why we would remove it. I would prefer to keep it. And if we do realize this is not a technical ordinance, but more has a policy component to it, I would prefer to think about, if the residential overlay doesn't exist, could it be changed? To finish, because I've talked for a while, of the three legs of the stool, go back to the one that has been removed for sure. That's a removal of a reference from the rural residential district. Well, at most you can say that the residential incentive overlay district doesn't function in that one district. And I realize that's where it's drawn. But in my opinion, there might be some value to revisiting the part of the zoning code that establishes a residential incentive overlay district in general, maybe improving it, see where it can be used in other parts of the city. So I guess that's my discomfort with it. That's my honest assessment of it. And I offer it in recognition that this is being pursued in good faith by the planning department, and that it's not really clear in what the status of this is. But I think it's worth some consideration. So that's just an update on the objections that I raised at the last meeting, which I offer respectfully for your consideration.
Councilor Murphy.
Mm-hmm. Well, the concept of overlay districts remains because there are other ones doing other things mm-hmm. as overlays in other parts of the city. Mm-hmm. And in this instance, as I understood it, what we're doing is removing the overlay from the map in the rural residential district because it's not supported by other parts of the zoning code anymore. but that doesn't mean they couldn't create another residential overlay in another zoning district where they feel it might be more appropriate. Is that a reasonable observation?
That's my, answer, I mean, that's my understanding, although the Ms. Mish has told me that the intention would be to come back and remove some of the references that I just mentioned. Mm-hmm. So, which I don't think I would support. I think I would support kind of studying, maybe fixing it rather than removing it.
Well, and you know, certainly they're saying rural residential is, in their opinion, not the place for this sort of incentive. But maybe URB or URC would be, much like the one that they're talking about doing down on Bridge Street. So the concept of doing a residential incentive overlay may make sense somewhere that isn't rural, but somewhere that's a little more urban.
If I may just briefly respond to that, I think it's good you raised that because now we're talking about policy. We're not just saying, oh, it's a moot point because we've done this already. Mm-hmm. We should ask whether we want it to be in that district, because it may be that we don't. But we should consider it, because I think there's a policy question, not just a technical change. Yeah.
Well, clearly the planners don't want it there. Because they've already taken out the underlying zoning and they just want to take it off the map now that it's not supported by the other part of the zoning ordinance.
That's right.
Councilor Sherrod, Councilor Bidwell.
Just to that point, I feel like the two times that I heard Ms. Mish talk about this, she did sort of, I felt like she addressed that policy concern that this, by the, they no longer wanted to support that policy, or that we did not have the infrastructure to support that policy. Therefore, that's why it was being removed.
Mm-hmm. I think it's true. I think the planning department has a position on it. And like I said, good arguments were articulated, but it's for the council to consider those policies as well, since we're the one who has to vote on it. My concern was we weren't doing that because we thought it was sort of a fait accompli. So I think it's good to raise those issues.
Councilor Bidwell.
I appreciate Councilor O'Donnell's careful analysis of this and the distinction between the legal aspects and the policy. On the legal, I do agree with the three legs of the stool analogy, and that only one of them has been addressed, but this is where the legal and the policy intersect. If you agree with the policy argument being made by staff, which I do, then you might as well get closer to being legally clear. And two legs of the stool, though not all three, is still better than just one. So I would argue that it gets in the direction of clarity, particularly if it's the intention for planning sustainability to come forward with the language changes that would take care of the third component of it too. And on the policy matter, it's not just a willy-nilly staff preference. It's very much embodied in Sustainable Northampton. I sat on that planning committee, and there's no question that the policy thrust of that whole document, which is kind of the guiding principles for zoning changes that have taken place since then, was very much to look at density of housing, whether affordable or not, in areas where infrastructure could support it, which is generally in closer to downtown. So I think there is substantial policy support for removal of this particular district. But I also think I'll go ahead and support this. But I do think it would make sense to ask Wayne and Carolyn to come back with something more specific about when they plan to clean up the rest of the language. But more importantly, do they have further thoughts on additional overlay districts that would accomplish what was originally intended with this one? So that's my take on it.
Anyone over here, Councilor?
Yeah. So at the hearing, Mr. Tebow was there, and a number of other people who had received notice in the mail about the map change, and they were expecting that that this was up for discussion. And we're learning at that hearing that no, we figured this out 2 years ago. Well, why didn't we get the notice 2 years ago? Well, because for that type of discussion, we don't send out notices. But when there's a map change 2 years later, after the regs have been changed, then we send a notice to you. So, you know, and here we have Mr. Tebow asking to not change the regs, which were already changed already. And so I'm conflicted as to how to vote here.
I would say that I don't disagree with Councilor O'Donnell insofar as policy discussion and crafting. I would say this is one of the worst ways to do it, however, because it's a response to an anomaly. And I think that this is something that should be percolating up from the planning office rather than having us generically make, you know, have a policy discussion that's prompted by this, whereas the larger philosophical discussion is establishing, creating high-functioning, sustainable affordability within the community, and what are the best ways to proceed to do that. And I think what we're hearing from, of course, as Councilor Bidwell said, from the planning office, is not the ideal circumstance in which to establish that. The criteria, the leg of the stool that has been removed, as you point out, is essentially, it's not the definitions, and the definitions are, they are a leg. I wouldn't say there is a robust leg, if we could start to put those qualities on them, because the regulations that where the definitions are applied or what is substantial. And I think, you know, of all these things, if you pulled out the map or if you pulled out the definitions and tinkered with them, you would still have the regulations that are dictated under that policy. All that said, I just think that, and I think I do agree, the absence of clarity is off-putting, but it's not unique. We've run into stuff like this before. And I think the more salient point in discussion ultimately is policy. And I like to see policy come from, percolate up to us as opposed to being prompted by this anomaly. That's all, that's my point. And Councilor Murphy. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and what was very clear in their presentation is there's a district that exists as an image on the map that is no longer supported by the zoning ordinance. So somebody could come in and say, I want to do something in the district. And they'd say, it's an empty it's an empty overlay on the map that is not supported by the zoning ordinance anymore. We're not going to permit you in there. It really is misleading. I do agree, the removal of the overlay on the map should have been coupled with the removal of the underlying zoning authorization for the overlay district so that it was all done at once. Why? It randomly took them 2 years ago. Oh my God, it's still on the map. We got to get it out of there. When in fact, its authorization went away 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. That befuddles me a little bit. I wish they'd have done it all at the same time, because for the public, they would have been noticed about both at the same time and come in, and the changing of the zoning authorization would have, you know, they would have been around for that rather than discovering 2 years later that it is in fact an empty overlay district, which is no longer authorized. I do see that as a credibility issue, and I wish they hadn't done it that way.
Councilor Barge?
Yes, I feel the same way that Councilor Murphy just stated in regards to if one of us had owned that property over there and you don't get any type of a notice or anything of a zoning changing there, to me, I think that's not the right direction to go. I don't know what we can do it as councilors, but I think it's unfair for Mr. Tatro to have to all of a sudden come to say, I was never notified. I do think that is in poor taste. So how do we correct this?
Well, that's to the larger point. The criteria by which people are notified and all that is established in a different context, and certainly it's policy that's not developed by us at this point. Maybe at some point come to us for approval, but I agree. I think, and as Councilor Murphy pointed out, if this had been done correctly, the map would have been part of it, and according to Councilor Nash, the map's the trigger for the notification. Mr. Tebow and his neighbors would have been notified at the time of the change. What we have here is a a mistake, not committed by this body, but one that we actually have. And what we also have here in this map, this is the equivalent of a vestigial tail, a thing that actually doesn't, well, and although this was Councilor O'Donnell's question before, because does this still serve functionally as allowing for development under the overlay criteria? So, and that was the question I was wondering if you, is that the one that the solicitor was murky on?
That's the question to ask the solicitor, and I don't want to,
right.
Well, I'll just say, I mean, it says something that a solicitor who is very experienced in zoning matters was not able to answer right off the top of his head, that it was still unclear. So that, you know, when it comes to the vestigial tail, it's not a vestigial tail. The tail is wagging a little bit, in my opinion. I mean, when you read this, you know, it's clear that overlay districts are established and what they are. They provide additional characteristics within a boundary, as depicted on a map. The residential incentive district is one such boundary. And I'm not clear on what principle. No one has explained this to me. What principle says that the underlying table of use must echo back to the overlay district what the overlay district dictates to the underlying district for it to be in effect? I don't understand that. So, in my opinion, it's unclear. And as the policy issue, I mean, I think it is for the City Council to make policy. Certainly, the Planning Department can make recommendations, but at the very minimum, we should recognize that this vote tonight is, you know, if only in an incomplete way, is making policy. It is endorsing the idea that we shouldn't have a residential incentive overlay district in this part of the city. And that's fine if that's the decision of the council, but we should recognize that it is a decision and not just a technical change.
Well, to be clear, and I think that the removal of this map does not remove the concept or actuality of a residential incentive overlay. That's
true.
That's still
true.
So that, as a policy, that still stands.
True.
As applicable. So
just not here.
Just not in. Just not on this pretty picture.
True.
So, Councilor Murphy.
I don't know. What's the council's pleasure? Do you want to invite our learned solicitor in here to answer the questions and continue and postpone this until
yes.
he can come see us, or do you not feel that strong enough?
Well, as the as kind of the lone objector, you know, I've given you my opinion, and I defer to the will of the council. I hate to hold things up.
It's entirely possible you're not the lone objector.
It's possible. Excuse me. Where's the person who's bringing this forward? So I wouldn't want to hold it up if it's the will of the council. I'm happy to defer to the council's. My vote will still be no, but that's just for the reasons I stated. So.
Councilor Klein, do you have your hand up? Okay. There it is.
I just want to say that I think there's a certain amount of pragmaticism here. It reminds me of when we've had a couple of times this situation where the DPW has already painted the bike lanes in and we have to ratify it after the fact. So we have a similar situation, but I think in terms of the policy piece, what is most salient here is that it does, as Councillor Bidwell said, it does resonate with the Sustainable Northampton Plan. And so that to me, you know, yes, it's backwards, or we're letting whatever the phrase is we want to use, we let the horse out of the barn or something like that. But on a very pragmatic level, I think it behooves us to move forward with a vote tonight and to as long as it resonates with the piece of Sustainable Northampton that we can support.
Councilor Nash or Councilor LaBarge? Councilor LaBarge?
Okay.
You guys gonna have a fight? Okay, all right. So who are we doing? Councilor Nash?
So, so I'd be more comfortable with delaying this in with the idea that Mr. Tebow meet with the Planning Department, and since he's just learned about this change in overlay, maybe possibly, you know, rather than that large overlay, a smaller one can be considered for the area where
his property is, which is off of King Street, which is where we're, you know, there's plans to put a new roundabout in, and sidewalks. It's near River Valley Market. And allow that that discussion and that information to get exchanged, and then hear back from the planning department as to how that got resolved.
My concern about that is that actually functionally, whatever vote we take tonight won't affect that conversation in all one way or the other. At least that's my impression, that as Councilor Klein has said, essentially, that whatever policy changes would have to come after the fact, you know, as the planning office makes their case or not. And Councilor O'Donnell's right, we do make policy here. My only argument is this: I don't think the optimal way to craft policy. I just think we're setting ourselves up for more confusion and complication when I'd rather build policy based on well thought out philosophy, that as opposed to keeping something that is an anomaly that does generate some confusion. Eliminating this map would certainly clarify that, but that's my thought.
To clarify, what I'm asking is to not vote tonight, simply delay it and allow some more discussion to happen, and then come back with more information.
Is that a motion?
That's a motion.
I guess that's a motion.
Thank you. And I'll second that.
Motion's made and seconded. So the motion for discussion now is to delay. Councilor.
Just to be clear, I appreciate that. I mean, I'm not trying to be, I'm not saying delaying would be obstructionist, but I personally don't want to be. So I'm fine if the will of the council is to vote on this tonight. So I'm fine voting on it tonight.
Okay. Councilor Bidwell, and this is on the delay.
I'll vote against the motion. I would like to see us proceed with a vote on this. There's been adequate discussion for my purposes, particularly if we were to accompany that with asking the mayor if he would ask the Planning and Sustainability Department if they would take a fresh look now that this has been removed, at least two of the three legs have been removed. If the Planning and Sustainability Department has, based on their analysis, further thoughts on another overlay district that would be more appropriately located, it would be my preference to not delay and to proceed with the vote.
Did you have your hand up?
Sort of related to this, but I'd also appreciate it if we can convince the Planning Department to not decouple the issues. That if they're going to change the underlying zoning, they're going to map at the same time to trigger the notice so that citizens know that they're fiddling around with one of these districts by having to do the map notice when they do the change. Not really ideally connected to this motion.
Councilor LaBarge, this is to the postpone, the delay.
This is what?
The motion that's on the floor is about the delay. So this is okay. Any other discussion on the delay? I can do this by voice vote, or we can do it by roll call. Roll call, please.
Councilor Klein?
No.
Councilor LaBarge?
No.
Councilor Murphy?
No.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
No.
Councilor Scherer?
No.
Councilor Bidwell?
No.
Councilor Dwight?
No. So motion fails. So we're back to the original. The original motion. So any other stuff on that? Okay, roll call, please.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
No.
Councilor O'Donnell?
No.
Councilor Scherer?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
All right, that passes in second reading. Okay, so now back to these financial orders. So the first item we're dealing with is item 17.267. This is an order to authorize a payment for a prior year bill for veteran services. First reading.
Move approval.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion on this item? waiting, I'm pausing, just stalling here. Ready? Roll call, please.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
All right, that passes in first reading. And we'll be revisiting that on our April 20th meeting. Item 17.268. This is an order authorizing senior services to accept gifts of $5,000 or less.
Move approval.
Second. Seconded. Discussion. Roll call, please, Pam.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Okay, well, that passes in first reading. Well, this is panning out. We're all going to get a first vote. We're all alphabetically. item 17.269, this is an order authorizing the appropriation of $1,465,692 from free cash for central services, OPS, ITSD, fire rescue, school, and DPW capital projects.
Move to approve.
Motion's made. Motion seconded. Discussion. Pam?
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Passes in first reading. Item 17.270, this is an order to appropriate $770,000 from the capital stabilization for school and public safety projects.
First move to point. Approve.
Motion's made and seconded. Discussion. Roll call, please.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Passes in first reading. Item 17.271, this is an order to authorize the appropriation of $517,000 from receipts reserved for appropriation parking for capital projects. Motion made, seconded. Discussion. Roll call, please.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
That passes in first reading. Our next item is 17.272. This is an order to authorize borrowing of $1,630,000. Right? Are we talking 1 million? I'm actually looking at 1,630 and then a decimal point with 3 zeros.
Should be a comma.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. $1,630,000 for the cost of engineering and construction of spillway repairs at Ryan Reservoir.
Move to approve.
Motion's made and way seconded. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
That passes in first reading. This is item 17.273, an order to authorize borrowing of $250,000 for the cost of repairs for the Audubon Road water tank.
Move approved.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes. Sorry, I'm getting bulletins all over the place. The U.S. has just done an airstrike on Syria, just to let you know. Next up is the item 17.274, this is an order to authorize borrowing of $250,000 for rehabilitation and replacement of the city's primary water main transmission lines.
Move approval.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Discussion? Roll call, please, ma'am.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor
O'Donnell?
Sorry.
What's his name?
You.
For what's his name?
It's okay. It's
Counselor
a long night.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
All right. That passes in first reading. Next up is item 17.275. This is an order to authorize appropriation from the Water Enterprise Stabilization Fund for various water department capital program expenditures.
Mm-hmm.
Discussion? Roll call.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shera?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Boyd?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
First reading. It's a whole lot quicker than the Finance Committee, isn't it? Item 17.276 is in order to authorize a borrowing of $500,000 for street resurfacing.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Discussion. I want to point out that, which we didn't point out, but should be reiterated, that the mayor's office is committed to investing community funds in addition to Chapter 90 funds to build up our street and improve our street inventory and to address deferred maintenance that's lasted for a long time. And as Councilor Murphy said, I think everyone will welcome it when it's done. When it's being done, not so much. But that I thought that was worth noting. Roll call, please, Pam.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shera?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Boyd?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes. That passes in first reading. Item 17.277 is in order to authorize borrowing of $755,000 to purchase vehicles for the Department of Public Works.
To approve.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shera?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Boyd?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes. That passes in first reading. Item 17.278 is in order to authorize borrowing of $375,000 for the Clement Street Bridge project.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any more discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Shera?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Boyd?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes. All right, that passes in first reading. Item 17.279, this is in order to authorize appropriation from the mayor's payment in lieu of taxes program to fund cardiac monitors for the fire rescue department.
To approve.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shera?
Yes.
Passes in first reading. Item 17.80, an order to authorize the appropriation of $35,200 on the purchase of wide area network switches for the city's fiber loop.
Move to approve.
Second.
A discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shera?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes. Okay, that passes in first reading. Item 17.281, this is in order to authorize the appropriation of $10,000 from a gift fund to be used for the playground equipment at Leeds and Bridge Street Elementary School.
Move to approve.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shera?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes. Item 17.282 is in order to authorize borrowing of $400,000 for window replacement at Forbes Library. First reading.
Approval.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call, please.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shera?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
That passes in first reading. Item 17.283, in order to authorize borrowing of $200,000 for the cost of an HVAC system installation and improvements at Forbes Library.
To approve.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shera?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Okay. Passes in first reading. Item 17.284 is in order to authorize reprogramming of $10,738 to partially fund fire alarm and smoke detector system upgrades at Forbes Library.
Move to approve.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call, please.
Counselor Nash?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shera?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Boyd?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
That passes in first reading. And item 17.263 is in second reading. That's an order to pay two prior year bills. Accept a motion?
Move to approve.
These were the bills for $186.88 to Cabot Strategies, $235 to your membership for water superintendent advertisement. Don't make me explain that again. Okay. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Boyd?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
That passes the second reading. Item 17.264, now we're into orders. That's an order to establish the water and sewer rates for FY 2018. This is the first read.
Second.
Discussion on this item. Pointed out, oh, Councilor Mark.
Oh, I was just going to point out, they're the same as last year, so.
Same as last year.
They're not changing.
And we had actually two presentations, essentially two hearings on these rates. And I have to say, I've not heard from a single constituent, even when I've reached out and asked them about it, especially when I told them that the rates are unchanged. It's like, okay, cool. So I don't know about anyone else, but in any event, yes, it should be noted that status quo. Any other discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Boyd?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yep.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
All right, that passes in first reading. The second reading will be April 20th. Item 17.285, this is an order to authorize the mayor to convey 91 Grove Street property to ServiceNet Incorporated. First reading.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and second. Any further discussion on this item? Roll call, please.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Boyd?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor
yes.
Passes in first reading. Now on to ordinances. This is these are second readings. Item 17.233. This is an ordinance relative to school zones.
Move approval.
Second.
Since being second, I have a letter. This is dated April 6, 2017. Dear counselors, the Montessori School of Northampton serves students from three counties across western Massachusetts. Many of our students stay with us from toddler age through eighth grade. Throughout the day, students are walking from our main building to the new middle school building across the street. And we care deeply about the well-being of our students, and we strongly encourage you to designate the area around the Montessori School of Northampton as a school zone. Our schools open from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., Monday through Friday. The current speed limit on Bates Street is 30 miles an hour, which is far too high for an area with young adults crossing the street throughout the day. Young students, I'm sorry, crossing the street throughout the day. The proposed 20 mile an hour zone will ideally be in effect for the duration of this time. In passing the school zone ordinance before you tonight, we would greatly appreciate your assistance in enacting a combination of traffic safety measures. Automated flashers would be an excellent way to make drivers more aware of the reduced speed limit. Police enforcement, automated speed cameras, legal in Massachusetts, double fines. These would all help to slow down traffic. Traffic calming measures such as curb extensions or raised crosswalks are frequently used in the local college community and would be a great option for the school zone. We thank you for your support designating Bates Street as an official school zone. Sincerely, David Lukens, Director of Development at the Montessori School. Sorry. Okay. Any further discussion on this? Okay. Roll call, please.
Councilor Boyd?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
That passes in second reading.
Great job.
Item 17.251. We did it.
Please don't.
So, bam.
Wait a minute.
Item 17.252. This is an ordinance to clarify the definition of structure for compliance with setbacks in 350-2.1 of said code. Second reading.
Second.
Any further discussion? This, you'll recall, is Councilor Nash's fences. Councilor Nash.
I just want to say that I had an informative email conversation with Ms. Mish, as well as the building commissioner, and really helped address all of my concerns around this. And so I'm going to support this tonight.
Anyone else? You ready for this one? Okay, roll call.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Chair?
Yes.
Councilor Fidler?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes. All right, that passes in second reading. Next up is item 265. This is for referral to the Committee on Legislative Matters. You may consider some other referrals, but let me put it out on the floor first. This is the ordinance relative to taxis and vehicles for hire. Accept a motion on the floor.
Move to refer.
Second.
Community resources be an appropriate committee for this to be discussed?
They actually are the ones that grant these licenses.
Yeah.
So it might be nice if they talked about it.
Okay. So would you accept that as an addition to the referral beyond legislative matters, but also
whatever
community resources?
Whatever referral people want to make is fine.
Okay. Sure. Any other?
It's also not my ordinance. It's the chief of police.
Yeah, it's chief of police. Yeah. Any discussion on the referrals? Everyone's okay. So this is for referral to the Committee on Legislative Matters and Resources. Okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Wow, look, two voice votes. I have no other updates. This is 9:41.
I'm going to do the other
one. We're not done yet.
I missed.
One. You missed
oh, damn it.
The other voice vote.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
You just told us there was one.
I'm sorry. I almost got close. Yeah, 17.
So close.
This is the other referral. This is item 17.288. This is the ordinance relative to on-street parking meter zones. This is to refer to the Committee on Legislative Matters and Transportation and Parking Commission.
Move to refer.
To approve.
Discussion on the referral?
Second.
Second. No. Nope. Okay. All those in favor of the referral, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Right now, how we do this. I have no updates.
God bless you.
All right. So I'll accept a motion.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
I was getting worried there. Thank you. Okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Thank you all very much.
That wasn't so late.